Good morning and welcome to worship this morning at St. Paul Lutheran Church in Hubbard Lake, Michigan. It is always a privilege to be able to gather together, especially for those of you that aren't able to be with us this morning in person for worship. It's truly a joy to be able to come together, even online during this time apart, and be able to hear God's word and join together our voices as we praise the Lord. Just a few things to remember as I kind of try to remind you every week about our worship time this morning. One, it is a worship service, and so we would love for you to join us and participate along with us by singing the hymns, following the readings, the prayers, the liturgy, and just participating as you would if you were here on Sunday morning. Also, we would love for you to say hello to your fellow brothers and sisters in Christ who are gathering with you right now online. Be they here in Hubbard Lake, in Alpena County, Alcona County, around the state of Michigan, and even as we have people join us from other states. Welcome them in the name of the Lord. Share the peace of Christ with them. Say hello as we gather together this morning. Let us open our time this morning on this 24th Sunday after Pentecost with our opening hymn, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. You have been our good and faithful Master. You have poured out blessings upon us. You have given us all that we need to support this body and life. We meditate on all that you have done. We ponder the work of your hands. On account of your name, O Lord, preserve our lives. In your righteousness, bring us out of trouble. Indeed, our Heavenly Father has done wonderful things for us. He has given us more than we could ever ask or imagine. Yet there have been times when we have been ungrateful for God's gifts, times when we have been lazy and selfish with what He has given us, times when we have been unfaithful servants.
Yet our Heavenly Father invites us to return to Him and ask for His forgiveness. Heavenly Father, we confess that we have not been faithful with all of the good gifts that You have given us. We have sinned in our thoughts, words, and actions. We have failed by our inactivity. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, O Lord, that we might be restored as Your servants.
God hears your confession and has promised to be with you always. Almighty God, in His mercy, has given His Son to die for you, and for His sake forgives you all of your sins. Therefore, as a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by His authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We are forgiven. We are restored in Jesus.
Hear my prayer, O Lord. Give ear to my pleas for mercy. In your faithfulness, answer me. In your righteousness, enter not into judgment with your servant, for no one living is righteous before you. I remember the days of old. I meditate on all that you have done. I ponder the work of your hands. I stretch out my hands to you. My soul thirsts for you like a parched land. Teach me to do your will, for you are my God. Let your good spirit lead me on level ground. For your name's sake, O Lord, preserve my life. In your righteousness, bring my soul out of trouble. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, you have given exceedingly great and precious promises to those who trust in you. Dispel from us the works of darkness and grant us to live in the light of your Son, Jesus Christ, that our faith may never be found wanting. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Old Testament lesson for this 24th Sunday after Pentecost comes from the prophet Zephaniah, chapter 1, beginning at verse 7. Be silent before the Lord God, for the day of the Lord is near. The Lord has prepared a sacrifice and consecrated his guests. And on the day of the Lord's sacrifice, I will punish the officials and the king's sons and all who array themselves in foreign attire. On that day, I will punish everyone who leaps over the threshold, and those who fill their master's house with violence and fraud. On that day, declares the Lord, a cry will be heard from the fish gate, a wail from the second quarter, a loud crash from the hills. Wail, O inhabitants of the mortar, for all the traders are no more, all who weigh out silver are cut off. At that time, I will search Jerusalem with lamps, and I will punish the men who are complacent, those who say in their hearts, the Lord will not do good, nor will he do ill. Their goods shall be plundered and their houses laid waste. Though they build houses, they shall not inhabit them. Though they plant vineyards, they shall not drink wine from them. The great day of the Lord is near, near and hastening fast. The sound of the day of the Lord is bitter. The mighty man cries aloud there. A day of wrath is that day, a day of distress and anguish, a day of ruin and devastation, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness, a day of trumpet blast and battle cry against the fortified cities and against the lofty battlements. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The epistle lesson for today comes from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, beginning at the first verse. Now concerning the times and the seasons, brothers, you have no need to have anything written to you, for you yourselves are fully aware that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying, there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them, as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. But you are not in darkness, brothers, for that day to surprise you like a thief, for you are all children of light. Children of the day, we are not of the night or of the darkness. So then, let us not sleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, having put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has not destined us for wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we might live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build one another up, just as you are doing. This too is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 25th chapter. Jesus said, "For it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted to them his property. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. He who had received the 5 talents went at once and traded with them, and he who made 5 talents more. So also he who had the 2 talents made 2 talents more. But he who had received the 1 talent went and dug in the ground and hid his master's money. Now after a long time, the master of those servants came and settled accounts with them. And he who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 talents more, saying, Master, you delivered to me 5 talents. Here I have made 5 talents more. His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. And he who had the 2 talents came forward, saying, Master, you delivered to me 2 talents. Here I have made 2 talents more. His master said to him, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master." He also, who had received the one talent, came forward, saying, "Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow, and gathering where you scattered no seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here, you have what is yours." But his master answered him, "You wicked and slothful servant, you knew that I reap where I have not sowed, and gather where I scattered no seed. Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and at my coming I should have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him, and give it to him who has the 10 talents. For to everyone who has will, more will be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. And cast the worthless servant into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Together let us confess our faith boldly in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Free with all who life inherit. grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The gospel readings for last week, today, and next week are all part of a private instruction that Jesus gave to his disciples on the Mount of Olives just a few days before he died on the cross. If Pastor Joe has been preaching on the Gospels, last week you would have heard the parable of the wise and foolish virgins. Next week, we will hear about the sheep and the goats. Today, we hear the parable of the talents. And Jesus used each of these readings to help us learn what we need to know about the last day, the day of judgment, the day when each of us must appear before the Lord and give an account. We're coming down on the close of the church year, and during these last several weeks and another couple of weeks to come, we will deal on the subject of the last days. The parable of the talents teaches that the servants of the Lord must be faithful by promptly and efficiently administering what has been entrusted to them until the day of reckoning. This parable of the talents is the longest parable in the Gospel of Matthew. It tells of a man who left on a long trip and returned at a later time. While he was away, he entrusted his wealth to three servants. When he returned, he called these servants before him to give an account of what they had done with his wealth. The amount was large enough that any mishandling on the part of the servants could bring about his ruin. The man in the parable represents Jesus, who was about to leave on that long trip. In a few days, he would be hanging from a cross and paying for the sins of all humanity. After he paid for all of our sins, he would rise from the dead and then ascend into heaven. The parable in the gospel illustrates our lives during this time of waiting for Jesus to return. During his absence, his followers are expected to work diligently with the gifts that he has entrusted to them. His followers are responsible to him at his return. The parable also illustrates the judgment that will come to each of us at the end of our time on this earth. I think it to be noteworthy that the master, entrusts his wealth to servants. But back then, you have to realize that servants were part of the extended family. He doesn't entrust his wealth to two servants and a stranger. The fact that he entrusts his wealth to servants indicates that Jesus is talking about people who consider themselves to be members of a congregation, members of a household of faith. Even as Judas was still a member of Jesus' congregation, so also we need to understand that not all who claim to be members are really members. As Jesus said in Matthew 7, verse 21, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Just as not all three servants were faithful, Jesus teaches that not all members are faithful. So far, I haven't said much about the 5, 2, and 1 talent that the man gave to each of his servants. This is by design, for fear that it would be easy to get hung up on the amounts. Instead, we understand that even one talent is a huge amount of money. We can realize that the man put each one of his servants in charge of a fortune. Even one talent could be worth millions of dollars. The stewardship this man entrusted to his servants was huge. The first part of this parable indicates the incredible wealth that God gives to us. He has created us and the entire world. The different amounts indicate that God gives a unique set of gifts to each person. He gives these gifts so that each of us can not only care for himself, but for each other as well. Most importantly, he has given Jesus, who earned salvation with his suffering and death on the cross. That salvation is not just for a few, but the salvation Jesus earned is for the entire world. It is, as Jesus said in the last half of the 45th verse of Matthew 5, "Our Father in heaven makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust." God's gifts to us are beyond anything we could measure or even imagine, and he gives those gifts to all people. We need to understand that the wealth in this parable is symbolic, though. There are many ways God's gifts can be a blessing to us. Just as God gives out different gifts, so also there are different returns when we invest those gifts. On occasion, the Lord may bless with a financial return, but most of the time, the return is much more valuable than mere earthly wealth. As the parable continued, two of the servants put their stewardship to work. They invested, and they made a return. The third servant dug a hole and buried the entire talent. He hid his master's money. He hid his master's gift. Jesus told this parable along with other parables to illustrate the final judgment on the last day. On that day, some will stand before the Lord and rejoice, like the two faithful servants. They will praise the Lord for the things they were able to do because of the Lord's gifts. But others will stand in terror. Some of those who stand in terror will have their names on the rolls of the local congregation. See, when we entered the world, all of us were like the servant who stood before the master in terror. It is as David says in Psalm 51, "Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me." The Apostle Paul writes in Ephesians, the second chapter, verse 1, "You were dead in the trespasses and sins." And again, Romans 8, verse 7, "The mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot." By nature, we are like the unfaithful servant. We imagine a master who is not generous, loving, and kind. Our imagination prevents us from seeing the true master who pours out generous salvation and all the other gifts without calculation or measurement. We imagine the master to be a hard man, reaping where he did not sow and gathering where he scattered no seed. That disbelief causes fear instead of joy. It paralyzes us so that the gifts of God terrify us, and many times we despise them. But fortunately, the Father of all mercy and grace has sent his Son, Jesus Christ, who atoned for the sin of the whole world, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. God does not desire our terror. Instead, he loves us. He loves us with the holy, precious blood of his Son poured out in innocent suffering and death on a cross. Jesus brought into this world a love that was priceless, a love that would not balk at the cost of sin, a love that would suffer eternal death and eternal damnation so that the debt of all humanity would be paid and every sin would be forgiven before God. God offers this love to us with a generosity that Jesus describes in Luke 6, verse 38, as a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. When the Holy Spirit creates faith in us, he brings this generous love and forgiveness to us. The terror is gone. Instead, we become like the two faithful servants who rejoiced in the presence of their master. Like the faithful servants, we will rejoice. We will rejoice in the presence of the master as we celebrate the return we will have made with the wealth the master gives to us. We will hear those wonderful words, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master." The terrified servant, you see, heard different words. He heard, "You wicked and slothful servant, you knew that I reap where I have not sown and gather where I have scattered no seed. Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and at my coming I should have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to him who has the 10 talents, for to everyone who has will more be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. And cast the worthless servant into the outer darkness. In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." This parable shows that there are two judgments on the last day, the joy of the master and the outer darkness. The other readings for this day also inform us of the terror of the day of the Lord. The Old Testament reading speaks of wailing, it speaks of punishment, plundering, waste, ruin, bitterness, devastation, darkness, and gloom. The epistle speaks of destruction and the labor pains of childbirth. These readings make it very clear that there will be a very real day of judgment, and that day will terrify many. It will even terrify some who claim membership in a local congregation. At the same time, there are some who look forward to that day with joy. You and I should. These are the ones whom God has brought into his household of salvation. By God's grace, we will celebrate and confess the gift of forgiveness, life, and salvation that God has given to us. God's love for us delights in the different gifts he gives to each of us. He rejoices in the various ways he has created us for service. As Paul writes to the saints in Corinth, "If the whole body were an eye, where would be the sense of hearing? If the whole body were an ear, where would be the sense of smell?" Throughout the centuries, the parable of the talents has spoken and continues to speak to all Christians. We are to be the channel through which the message of God's word flows to the world around us. The servant entrusted with 1 talent kept the deposit safely in a hidden place. He feared to put it to use, for he knew that his master would demand the talent from him upon his return. Fear, therefore, completely overshadowed love, it overshadowed trust, and it overshadowed faith. We all know that fear is the opposite of confidence. The Christian who puts faith to work will reap immense dividends. He's not concerned about himself and his own interest. For whatever he owns belongs to the Lord, and whatever he does for the Lord. No follower of Jesus can ever say that he lacks the gifts to be of service simply because he is not a Paul, or he's not a Luther, or he's not a Calvin, or he's not a Knox. The parable teaches that every servant has received gifts, each according to his ability. Jesus knows the capability of every Christian, and he expects an increase. The basic teaching of the parable of the talents is that every believer has been endowed with gifts differing according to his abilities, and that these gifts must be put to use in God's service. Remember, however, our service to God does not earn us a place in his kingdom. God has freely given us that in Christ. Instead, God gives us a variety of gifts. At the same time, he gives us our place in his kingdom. Those who rejoice in the coming day of the Lord will readily use these gifts to confess their faith to their friends and acquaintances. And who knows, but that the Holy Spirit may use your confession to bring salvation to another, so that they too will one day hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master." Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Thank you so much to Reverend Kirsten from Emmanuel in Alpena for coming today and joining us this morning and bringing us God's Word. As we typically do when we gather together, we are unable to obviously pass an offering plate and make our gifts unto the Lord. But there are several ways that you can still continue to give with a cheerful heart and be faithful in that giving. One, you can mail your gift right here to the church office or even drop it off on your way to and from town. Second, you can go to our website and utilize our online giving platform. It's very easy and safe to do so. And finally, you could text the word GIVE, G-I-V-E, to 989-309-2496. Thank you so much for your faithfulness in your giving and allowing us as God's church here in Hubbard Lake to continue to meet people where they are at and to take the gospel of Jesus Christ wherever we go. Having given our offerings unto the Lord, we go to our Father in heaven now with words and praises of thanksgiving in the singing of our offertory and in the speaking of our stewardship liturgy. Everything we have is a gift from God. All that we have and are belong to God, bought with the blood of Jesus. Lord, help us be a people who live lives of sacrificial generosity, that through our generosity your love would be known. Keep us from the delusion of wealth and riches, and remind us that our treasure is in Christ. Increase our generosity so that there are no needy persons among us. Grant us faithfulness in our stewardship of such a small thing as money, that Christ may trust us with true riches. Above all, let us be generous, because our Father is generous, and it is our joy to share his generous heart with the world. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Almighty God, everlasting Father, you are worthy of being praised for all your gifts and graces which you give to us, your unworthy people. Hear us this day as we cry to you for mercy toward all people as they have need. You have made us your people and preserved us through the ministry of your word and sacraments. Continue, Heavenly Father, to pour out upon us grace upon grace, that we may be kept in faith and guarded in hope. Make your church throughout the world one in doctrine, confession, and life, and give to your church faithful pastors who will preach and teach your word with conviction. Deliver us from confusion and error by the power of your Holy Spirit, and raise up those who will continue to serve in faithfulness and humility. Deliver all enemies of your church and convert their hearts to repentance and faith. Strengthen all Christians in their faith and in their vocation of service as your children, that we may be obedient to your word and receive the salvation of our souls. Deliver the nations from oppression and ungodly rulers and governments. Bless all those in authority within our own nation, that righteousness may flourish and injustice end. Bless all those places where your people teach and learn, that our children may honor you, walk in your command, and show forth in their lives the fruits of the Spirit. Pervert all disaster and calamity. Deliver us from war and violence, and spare us from pestilence. Help us to know and rejoice in the good fruits of the earth, Heavenly Father. Bless all noble occupations, and help the arts to flourish, that our lives may be enriched by beauty. Help us, Heavenly Father, to receive with thanksgiving the fruits of the earth that you supply for our common good. Receive with our song of praise and sacrifice of thanksgiving the tithes and offerings that we bring, that through good use of the skills, talents, and time that you have given to us, you may be glorified in all that we are and all that we do. Give unity to your people, that we may not be divided in doctrine or witness, and grant us grace, that we may come to you and receive the good and gracious gifts that you have to give. Give to the sick healing, to the suffering relief, to the grieving hope, and to the dying peace. Hear us especially upon those who we name in our hearts. Sustain us in the day of trial. Deliver us from all of our enemies of body and soul, and keep us steadfast in the day of trouble. Remembering that here we have no abiding city, but heaven is our home, give us your aid, so that we may be true in our faith and godly living. Prepare us for the coming of your Savior, doing the works that you have called us to do and accomplishing your purpose in our daily lives. Help us to multiply your mercy by loving our neighbor in need and loving you with all of our body, soul, and strength, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor, and give to you his peace. Amen. We close with our final hymn this morning, Take My Life and Let It Be.
Take my hand.
Thank you so much for joining us online for worship this morning. It has truly been a joy and a privilege to be able to gather with you. Again, thank you so much to Pastor Kirsten from Emmanuel for joining us this morning, as I was not able to be here to lead worship and to preach in-person worship. And so he was kind enough to come and record this a few days ago to be able to bring you the Word of God this morning. Just a couple of announcements as we break for the rest of our week this morning. First, coming up on the 16th, which is tomorrow, Women's Ministry is having their second meeting. Their first meeting, it was exciting. There was all kinds of women there. It was great. They were able to maintain social distancing and still be able to gather together. And so if you are interested in that, I would certainly encourage you to come and join them 1 o'clock tomorrow afternoon and be able to just gather with them for some good conversation, some study in God's Word, and discussion about all kinds of different things. Also, a few other things that are upcoming. We are going to be taking our poinsettia orders. The order form is here at church. It's this little pink slip. If you would like to make sure that you get a poinsettia in memory or in honor of someone, please stop by the church office Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. Monica would be more than happy to assist you with that. You can even call the church office and discuss it with her, and she'd be more than happy to assist you with your poinsettia order. Also, we have a date for our snowflake event, our snowflake and sleigh ride event, which we had last year. It was very fun, very successful, but it's going to take place on the 16th of January, and we'll start selling tickets here coming up in the next few weeks, probably the beginning of December, but do note the date. Mark that on your calendar. The 16th of January, we will have our snowflake and sleigh ride event. Lastly, as we get to the end of the year, we are getting closer to our final voters assembly of the year. That voters assembly is scheduled for the second Sunday in December. We are going to make sure that we put out a nice and detailed agenda for you to see, to look at. If you would like a copy of that agenda mailed to you, please call the church office and let them know that. I will try to be put out a phone call blast to let people know that for those individuals who did not watch this morning or perhaps are unaware of that. But if you would like a copy of the agenda for that December meeting, it will be available in the office. Probably not until the end of the month. Also, coming up at that meeting, one thing that I can for sure tell you is that we have the election of officers. The office of president, financial secretary, and recording secretary are all officer positions that are up for election. If you would like to nominate someone to one of those positions, please contact Keith Rich, Doug Cuffert, or Mark Ames, and they would be more than happy to take your nomination and to forward that on to the appropriate place. That's it again for our time of worship this morning. Thank you so much for joining us. We will be praying for you this week. We would ask that you would be praying for all of those individuals who venture out into the woods, not only today, but throughout this next week to go hunting. Pray for their safety. Pray that God would be with each of them. And we are certainly praying that God would be with you not only this day, but throughout the week. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Mm-hmm.